Good morning, Sand Springs Church. Who's ready to worship this morning? Yeah, good. Well, welcome to Palm Sunday. I just want to encourage y'all to get excited as we get ready to walk into worship. As the service goes on, as people come in, if there's empty seats, if y'all would just scoot in closer together, that would be great. There are a few ways that we like to give our offerings. It's also an act of worship. And so we can do online, the giving boxes in the front and the back of the sanctuary, mobile or in my pocket. Oh, I'm just kidding. So let's get ready to worship.
Hello.
we just give another hand to the Lord this morning? If y'all would grab y'all's communion cups. Communion is another act of worship, and so we're going to incorporate that in with our worship this morning. Reading this week, you know, this is Palm Sunday. We're ushering in the arrival of the King, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And as Jesus came riding in on a colt of a donkey, the people cried out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." And as we prepare our hearts, I would just ask you that if all the burdens and all the things that the hurts and the pain, that you would lay him at his feet this morning. Whether it was an argument that you had before coming to service this morning or whatever it may be, that you would just lay it at his feet as we get ready to take his body. Just ask that you would just break that wafer as his body was broken for us and our sins. That he took the punishment that we deserved in our place. The beating, the bloodshed, all the agony that he endured for us. Because he saw the value in our lives. That he has so much love for us that we can't even fathom. Father God, I thank you for your son Jesus. We thank you for his body, which was broken for us on our behalf. What we so rightly deserved, he took the punishment on himself, Lord, so that we could be free. Hell has lost another one. I am free. Father God, we proclaim your body over us, and we declare freedom and liberty in Jesus' name. Continue working on our hearts. Lord, allow us to rid ourselves from the things that hinder us from having a closer intimacy with you. Lord, that your blood speaks a better word. That the blood that was shed has cleansed me, has cleansed us. Lord, your blood has washed us white as snow. And any lies that Satan is trying to bring to our minds right now, we cast it out in Jesus' name, because the blood is enough. Your cleansing, wonder-working, powerful blood, Jesus. Lord, and as we take your blood, let us remind us of the sacrifice that was given. Lord, it washes us of sin, and we are clean.
Nothing There was a moment when the lights went out, when death it claimed its victory. The King who loved had given up his life. The darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners. For every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. But not the end we could have known. For the earth began to shake. And the veil was torn. What sacrifice was made as a heaven's roar. Oh, hail King Jesus. Oh, hail the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, hail King Jesus. Oh, hail the Savior of the world. Oh, the Savior of the world. There was a moment when the sky lit up, a flash of light breaking through. When I was lost, he crossed eternity. Oh, the King of Life was on the move, yes, or in a dark, cold tomb, where I
worship you this morning, King Jesus. You are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And everything that needed to have been done, you have done it. You have accomplished what you came for the salvation of humanity. And we glorify you today. We come for a salvation celebration. And we just thank you, Lord, for all that you've done in our lives and the blessings of knowing our King. Thank you, Lord. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, it is Palm Sunday, and Palm Sunday is the first day of the greatest week of the calendar year. And so it's what we call Passion Week, some call Holy Week. It is the week in which every day, I want to encourage you every day, wake up and just think on Jesus. Read Scripture and just continue to remind yourself we're celebrating the week in which he comes to Jerusalem and is making his way towards the cross. Because had he not done that, we'd all still be lost. And so I want to look in the book of John. This is it's called the triumphal entry, as Jesus is making his trek towards the cross. And the first day he comes in, and it was on a Sunday. We know through the Scriptures. He comes in on a Sunday into Jerusalem. He comes down the Mount of Olives. I walked down the very same pathway. I can envision it now. And as he comes down the Mount of Olives, they rolled out the red carpet for him, basically. The next day, a great multitude, this is John 12:12. The next day, a great multitude that had come to the feast, when they had heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him and cried out, "Hosanna." Hosanna means save now. "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel." And Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, said on it, as it was written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold," everybody read this with me, "your King is coming." Amen. Sitting on a donkey's colt. They were celebrating the coming of the King. They had heard of Jesus. Many had heard that the Messiah is now amongst them. They had heard of him raising the dead. Many of his disciples are there. Some who are in this crowd had been fed by him miraculously, as he fed the 5,000, and then he fed the 4,000, and some of them would have been healed by Jesus and had seen his power, and they are celebrating the coming of the Messiah. In the book of Luke, in Luke chapter 19, it says, "Blessed," in verse 38, "blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." There's always going to be Pharisees. Y'all know that? There's always going to be people who are irritated by your worship. They're just going to be just a deadhead, and they just cannot understand how you get excited about Jesus. They just don't get it. There's always going to be Pharisees that are they got just enough of religion to make them miserable. And there's always going to be those. But here's what Jesus' response with him, verse 40. "But he answered and said to them, I tell you that if these," his disciples, "should keep silent, the stones would immediately cry out." Amen. Amen. Now, we love this verse of Scripture. We just think, man, that is so cool. He's talking about just the earth itself would just break forth in praise. And I want you to know, as we look at that, it's more than just some cool little statement that Jesus made. There's something more to it than that. And it's not just what we would call personification. Like, there's Psalm 98. We're going to look at Psalm 98. We're going to read the whole psalm. Psalm 98 says, "Oh, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have gained him the victory. The Lord has made known his salvation, his righteousness he has revealed in the sight of the nations. He has remembered his mercy and his faithfulness to the house of Israel, and all the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout joyfully to the Lord." That's what we just were doing. Amen. "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth in song." I want you to see verse 4. "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth." Now, I know we would think, well, it's talking about the people of the earth. That's not the way this scripture goes. Verse 5, yes, it does include the people. "Sing to the Lord with the harp and the sound of a psalm, with trumpets and the sound of a horn." By the way, If y'all play some brass instruments, we want you on our praise team. I'm a fella that likes some horns up in here. And y'all are depriving us of this scripture right here. We want some horns up in here. So it says, with the trumpets, verse 6, with the trumpets and the sound of a horn, shout joyfully before the Lord, the King. Saxophone would be fine. It don't have to be a trumpet. Saxophone would be awesome. Verse 7, catch this. Let the sea roar in all its fullness, the world and those who dwell in it. So the earth wasn't talking about people. It was talking about the earth. Because it says the world and those who dwell in it. The world itself, creation itself. Let the rivers clap their hands. Did y'all know rivers had hands? But when you're in that river and you hear the rushing of the waters, it kind of sounds like applause, doesn't it? Amen. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills be joyful together before the Lord. Did you know that the hills could be joyful? The hills can be joyful. Now, is this just personification? Let's just read on. Let the hills be joyful together before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth with righteousness. He shall judge the world and the peoples with equity. In other words, every wrong he's going to make right. Everything that has been corrupted in this world, he's going to fix. And so the world itself, is this just some art form of personification, giving people-like qualities to nature itself? Well, it could be, but I'm going to tell you what can't be, and that's Romans chapter 8. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 19, it says, for the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pangs together until now. And what Jesus was saying when they said, make your disciples quiet down. They don't need to be worshiping you. You're just a man. They don't need to be worshiping. You make them be quiet. He said, Mr. Pharisee, you may not get it. And they may not fully understand what's going on, but the creation itself understands what's going on. And if they hush, creation will erupt in praise. Amen. Can you just think about just rocks just opening? I didn't know rocks had mouths. And they just start reverberating in worship. I always think that outdoors people are just a little step closer to God anyway, because we got there in creation and just see the goodness of God. In fact, Romans chapter 1, if you look at Romans chapter 1, it says that creation itself testifies that there is a God, that we have a witness within us that there's a God, and then we have a witness all around us that says there's a God. You don't look at a painting and wonder if there was a painter. You know there was. You don't look at a sculpture and wonder if there was a sculptor. It's evidence that there is one, right? Creation is evidence that there is a creator God. And he is amazing. And he is creative. And he is so diverse in his creation that everywhere I get to go to see the goodness of God and different types of nature, I guess you'd say, different kinds of landscapes, I'm just blown away by the goodness of God. It's never boring, is it? I've seen some beautiful places here in America. I've stood on the Isle of Skye there in Scotland and watched the waterfalls just fall off, you know, for hundreds of feet down into the ocean, and just want to just do like the rock, just burst forth in worship. Man, ain't God good. Isn't he amazing? And so Jesus, when he said that, he wasn't just funning. He wasn't just joking. He wasn't just trying to be cute. He said, no, creation gets it, even if you don't. Creation gets it. When Jesus was born, creation celebrated because it got one step closer. Look with me in Genesis chapter 3. It was, creation was made in the fullness of its freedom. And when sin entered into the world, that's when the curse came upon creation. Curse came upon this earth. in verse 17, Genesis chapter 3, verse 17, then to Adam, God said, because you have heeded the voice of your wife and have eaten from the tree which I commanded you, saying, you shall not eat of it, cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall bring forth to you. And you shall eat of the herb of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread. With the curse came labor, came toil, came sweat. The earth itself now grows, making it difficult to farm it. Thorns represent, and this is the passage of Scripture, thorns represent sin. I didn't even give this to the first service. Y'all finna get it. Just came to me. Thorns represent sin. Everybody look up. Jesus wore the thorns on his head as a crown. My sweet daughter-in-law has done an amazing job creating us a ginormous crown of thorns. And I was out in the field over this weekend, just kept getting thorns in me. And just like, I wish these weren't here. And the pain of thorns, the thorns represent sin. And Jesus defeated sin. Amen. It represents the curse, and Jesus reversed the curse. Amen. And so here's this passage of Scripture. It says creation, it was created in the full expression of its freedom. And yet because of sin, it was corrupted and brought into bondage. Turn with me back to Romans chapter 8. We're going to read again verse 19. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. I believe that on the day Jesus was born in that little town of Bethlehem, that creation celebrated because it was the revealing of the Son of God. Amen? Y'all better work. Help me. Help me as I preach this morning, all right? I bet creation just erupted in worship because we're one ginormous step closer to full freedom. One huge step closer to being freed from the bondage of corruption and the sin. And I bet creation was just excited when all of heaven has now entered into earth with the coming of Jesus. And so verse 19, for the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing, not of the Son, because he's already been revealed. It would be a capital and singular, but it's of the sons of God. Amen? And daughters, y'all ain't out on this thing. The children of God. Creation is waiting expectantly for the revealing of the children of God. Now, I know that there's layers to prophecy. So, let me see if I can kind of give you an example. Bible prophecy can be a little confusing at times because you're looking at events that have been separated as if it's one event. So, you go to a mountain range and you look across those mountains and it's like, they look like they're all together, but in fact, there may be miles and miles between one set of mountains. Everybody with me on that? So Bible prophecy is very similar to that. It's as if you're looking at the entire range and yet there's some distance from one event to the next. And so from the time Jesus first came, the Son of God was revealed, till now the sons and daughters of God are being revealed, to his return in which we will be fully revealed. Everybody with me on that? Bible prophecy, there's going to be a final fulfillment of this verse of Scripture in which when Jesus returns, all of those born-again saints will return with him. And creation will get to celebrate because the curse is done. Amen. So Jesus reversed the curse on the cross. He for us children of God, we now we can see God's salvation in our lives. We can see healing in our lives. We can see deliverance in our lives. There is that opportunity for us to get past the curse. And yet, I still get sick every now and then. And I still watch people die, and it breaks my heart, and that's all in this verse of Scripture. And yet there will be a day when I won't ever be sick again. There'll be a day when I won't ever go to one more funeral. I won't ever grieve one more loss. There'll be that day. That will be the final fulfillment of this verse of Scripture. But please don't read this and think, oh, that's all future. No, it's not all future. In fact, it says in the scriptures that heaven celebrates when one person comes to Christ. I believe earth does too. That earth is just like, oh, we're one closer. that the creation itself is like, oh, we're one closer. We're getting so close to the Creator coming again to reverse the curse and make right what has been wronged. I don't know if y'all catching this. That's why I get excited. Verse 20, for the creation was subjected to futility. You know what futility means? It's like what Solomon wrote in Ecclesiastes, a chasing after the wind, vanity of vanities. It's just like there's this endless cycle of birth, labor, toil, death. Birth, labor, toil, death. It's just like Ecclesiastes is one of the most depressing books in the Bible. Like, good night. Solomon, could you not get it together? It just looks so depressing, and because it's just this endless cycle of struggle and toil and death. And so this is what this futility is mentioning. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of Him, capital H, God, who subjected it in hope. What is this about? Well, when sin entered into humanity, everything became accursed because of it. And so God could not allow man to live forever in a sinful state. Now it just could not. Can you imagine if no one ever died and we were all sinners? Can you imagine what this world would look like? And you got people hundreds of years old who have perfected their sin nature. They learned how to do it real good. And that's just gross. God said, no, we can't let that happen. And so creation itself become under the bondage of corruption. Verse 21, because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption. And so we see there in Genesis chapter 3, because of sin, the curse comes. But there will be a day when we go back to the Genesis 1 and 2. When the curse is over, you actually see it in the book of Isaiah, and there's passage of scripture, this cool passage of scripture that says the lion and the wolf will lie down with the lamb, and the child will put his arm in the viper's pit and not have to worry about it. What is all those weird things talking about? It's going back to early in Genesis when everything was in harmony. There were no carnivores until sin. Everything lived in harmony back then and will again. And creation is just like, I can't wait. Don't you know that little gazelle out there on the Serengeti Plains is like, I cannot wait. Tired of running for my life all the time from these crazy lions. I can't wait. And so, verse 21, because creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty. I want everybody to catch this. Everybody say glorious liberty. Of the children of God. Amen. I hope you're seeing it. Creation says, we're going to get to get in on what they get. Woo. As a child of God, you can live in glorious liberty. Amen. And should be. We can live in glorious liberty. And creation itself is saying, man, I want to get in on what they got. For we know, verse 22, that the whole creation groans. I've never been much of a tree hugger, but I understand that you can put listening to devices to trees, and they're actually making sounds. And I do know that you can listen to the earth, and it makes groans. That's how they know when an earthquake's about to happen, a volcano's about to happen. Just a few months ago, I was at the base of Mount Vesuvius. They're in Italy, and they said this thing could erupt any time. I'm like, well, I better get out of here. It could erupt any time. I'm like, I hope those listening devices are working real good, and my plane flies real fast. But creation itself groans and labors with birth pangs and together until now. You know the interesting thing about birth pangs? They don't go on forever. Are you happy about that, ladies?
Yeah.
That the more they increase in intensity and frequency, you know something's about to happen. You know something's about to happen. And this is what creation, it's like, it's just like something's about to happen. And I don't know if he's returning with the eclipse. Some of y'all may be all about that. I don't know. There are signs in the heavens that we can read. That in fact, the Magi read the signs of the heavens and said, the Messiah has been born. Amen. So I don't know. I tell you this, you better be ready. He may come before then. You don't know. But be ready. Creation is like, oh, I can't wait. I can't wait. And so creation itself is ready and waiting. And so when the Pharisees said, preacher, Jesus, make them quit praising you. Jesus is saying, Mr. Pharisee, all you got's religion and you don't get it. But this world gets it. The Creator has come and is coming again. And it will liberate, he will liberate everything. Amen? Not just everyone, but everything. Creation itself will be liberated. And I want you to continue to read in verse 24. It says, not just creation groans, but we ourselves. Verse 24, for we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait. This is over and over and over again. Eagerly wait, eagerly wait. We eagerly wait for it with perseverance. I missed the verse 23. Not only that, but we also, we have the first fruits of the Spirit. Even we ourselves groan within ourselves. Eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. I mentioned earlier how because of Jesus, the stripes that he bore, I can receive healing. But unless he comes back, unless the Lord Jesus returns before my death, I'm going to get sick again. And I'm going to die eventually. And you know what? That frustrates me. It frustrates me to watch my loved ones get sick and watch family members die. And it frustrates me. And I just, it's like one of these days it's not going to be like this anymore. He's going to wipe away every tear. There will be no more sickness. There will be no more death. And even though it's somebody that maybe they lived a good long life, there's still just a groaning within me. You know what I'm talking about? Like, I don't know how to express it. You just, when you don't have words, you can just groan. The scriptures tell us in this passage that earth groans. We groan. We groan. And what's it saying? We're wanting the adoption of our bodies. I ain't old. but mama told me when I got on my first junior bill at 12 years old, and that began my time riding, doing some rodeo stuff. I had a dirt bike at 10 years old. I broke my collarbone. I began breaking bones at that point. And they continued, and quite a few. We had quite a few trips to the emergency room. And Mama would say, you're going to feel this when you get old. I guess I am old. Because I feel it now. I just begin to, I have the aches. The other day, we don't watch the news because it's depressing. But the other night, my old knees were hurting. I was just kind of rubbing my knees. And Chris said, is it going to rain? I don't know. I hadn't watched the weather. You know what happened during the middle of the night? It rained. We woke up the next morning. She said, your knees were right. I was like, I know. I remember that injury and how come I hurt when it rains. And so this is the part of this corrupted body and that why my soul groans looking forward to the day where I don't have those aches and pains and I don't see people die, and I don't struggle with sickness, and I'm looking forward to that day. I've sat at the bedside of too many people and watched them take their last breath, and you just groan. It's like, oh, it don't have to be this way, and it's one of these days, it's not going to be this way. So we groan within ourselves, and then it says that not only the earth groans, not only we, our souls groan, but verse 25, but if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. I don't know what your prayer life is like, but sometimes in our prayer life, we just run out of words, don't we? God, I just don't know. You don't have to. He comes alongside us, and the Holy Spirit groans with us. And it's as if he's saying, I know, child, one of these days we'll all be liberated. You'll all be liberated. Now, when we look at this scripture, when it helps us to understand what Jesus was saying when he said, oh, if they hush, the rocks will cry out. Because it's one giant step forward to full liberty. Amen. One giant step forward to full liberty. When Jesus was born, the Son of God was revealed, and heaven and nature sang. When he went to the cross, the scriptures tell us he came to his own, and his own, this is John chapter 1, he came to his own, and his own received him not, but to as many as has received him, to them, us, he gave the right to be called children of God. Amen. In this verse of scripture, it says, let's look at verse 19 again. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the children of God, the sons of God. If you back up, verse 14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Children, daughters also. And so look at verse 16. The Spirit, capital S, means it's the Holy Spirit, himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. If you came here this morning and you don't have that internal witness that you're a child of God, you can leave here with it. Amen. If you don't have the Holy Spirit resonating with your spirit, then it could be that your spirit is still dead. And this is why we have what we call salvation, why it's called being born again. And that your spirit has now been regenerated, and now you can hear God, you can know God, you can sense God. The Pharisee couldn't sense God, even though the Son of God was standing right in front of him. The Pharisee couldn't pick up on that because all he had was religion. All he had was a checklist, and man, he went by the checklist. The Bible tells us that the Pharisee would strain out his spices to make sure there wasn't even a gnat in his spices. He was so meticulous in his religion that he would take his spices and sift them through a sieve and make sure there wasn't an unclean animal in his, or bug, in his spices. And Jesus says, by the way, if you want to be saved, you got to be more righteous than him. Like, I can't beat that. I can't beat that. Well, you can't, but he did. Because all the Pharisee had was religion. He had rules and ritual. But with Jesus, I have a relationship. And now I don't have to wonder, am I going to heaven? I don't have to wonder, am I saved? I don't have to wonder, am I under the judgment of sin? I don't have to wonder about that because his spirit witnesses to my spirit that I'm a child of God. And if you come today and you're wondering, please don't leave wondering. We're going to have an invitation in just a little bit, and it's an opportunity for you to come down here and talk to somebody and say, I'm just not real sure. But you can be sure when you leave. And then when you've been regenerated, that spirit within you has been made alive, which was dead. Now his spirit can speak to your spirit, and now you can know that you are a child of God. Let's read that again. Verse 16, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. As we look at these passages of Scripture, I get excited. When Jesus said, hey, if they stay quiet, the rocks will burst forth in praise. What is he saying? You may not get it. They don't fully understand it, but creation has seen. Because creation's been around for a little bit. You know what I'm talking about? Creation has seen the liberty that it once had, the oppression that it now has, and is looking forward to the liberty that it once has again. Amen. I want to be like John the Baptist. John the Baptist, see, creation is ready and waiting. John the Baptist was going around saying, make ready, make ready. I think Waylon Jennings read the book of Isaiah when he wrote the theme songs of Duke of the Hazzard. Because it's the exact same words. He said, straighten the curves and flatten the hills. That's what John the Baptist said. Straighten the curves and flatten the hills. Make ready for the King is coming. Make ready for the King is coming. You go out East Texas, deep East Texas, around the Alto area, you'll find the Camino Real. That means the way of the King. Because the King of Mexico would come up into that region of Texas, and there would be people that would go before him, and they're getting the pathway ready. And John the Baptist would come along and say, get ready, the King is coming. Now, he didn't look like a king. He was born in a cave, most likely, and laid in a feeding trough and wrapped in strips of cloth. He didn't look like a king. But the Magi had been studying the skies, and they said, oh, no, the King is here. And they come with gold and frankincense and myrrh, and they brought bringing royal gifts to the king. In fact, they told Herod the Great, said, we've come to worship the king. And that's why Herod got offended, because he thought he was the king. But no, heavens said, the heavens declared that Jesus is the king. And the king has come. And then the king comes in this passage of scripture. That's why they laid the palm branches. They were rolling out the red carpet, and they're celebrating. In comes the king. But the tone changed, because he didn't come in the way they thought he would. He didn't come in on a white stallion, this mighty steed, as a conquering king, as a warrior king. He didn't come to free them from the Romans. That's what they wanted. They wanted a better lifestyle now. They wanted a better economy now. And he said, no, I'm a different kind of king. Pontius Pilate said, are you a king? And Jesus said, you said it. You said it. Yeah, he's a king. But he was a different kind than they expected. So the tone changed from Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, to crucify him. Crucify him. He's not what we thought he was. We liked eating his bread. We liked receiving his healing. But he's not liberating us from the Romans. And so crucify him. Maybe he hasn't done things the way you wanted him to do it. Maybe you had different expectations. I'm going to tell you something. He is the king. He is the king. And nature sees it. Nature recognizes it because he's the creator. So creation recognizes the creator. Do you recognize it? Have you been ready and waiting? Are you expectantly looking for Jesus? Please let me help you with this. I'm not just talking about his second coming. He's here today. He comes to us every day. Are you so spiritually in tune that when the kingdom is active, that you pick up on it? That you sense it? That when the Spirit speaks, you hear? That when the kingdom of God is on the move, you're moving with it? Amen. Are you a part of what he's doing here? If not, you may be just as dead as a Pharisee. He said, why are they worshiping? You're just a man. No, he's not just a man. He proved that. Not by his death. He proved it by his resurrection. Amen. And he poured out his Spirit upon us. And now you have an opportunity to also be of that Spirit. We're going to have a time of prayer. I want you to just bow your head and close your eyes and do a little spiritual inventory. Are you certain of your salvation? Is there a day in which you declared him as your king? Is there a day that you can go back to over your mental timeline, you can go back to in your history, and you say, okay, on that day I recognized that I was a sinner. And then I needed a Savior. On that day, I bowed to my King. On that day, I made him my Lord. Asked him to wash away my sins. Because of what he did on the cross. On that day, things changed for me. If you don't have a moment in your history in which you made him your King, then that needs to be today. Today is the day of salvation. Lord God, I pray that you would just stir every heart here, that we would recognize there's a kingdom operating in this room. And the King is here. May we not be so spiritually dull that we don't recognize it. But Father, that you would just stir in our hearts the fact that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and the Spirit is here to testify of that. And may we respond just like Jesus said creation was ready to do, poised for praise. May we, every one of us, respond to say, oh, he's my King. I made him the Lord of my life, and here I am ready to worship him. Father God, I pray that you would absolutely stir in our hearts exactly where we are, that would become very clear to us, and exactly where we need to be, that would become very clear to us. Lord, stir in our hearts that we might call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. But not only that, that as children of God, we would be sensitive to the kingdom of God. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before we go forward in the invitation, I've been skipping over a verse of Scripture that maybe it could be one of your favorite verses of Scripture, and you're wondering why I've skipped it. And stand with me while I bring your attention to Romans 8. For I consider that the struggle that we go through now, the struggle that Adam and Eve got us started on, that why it's got to be labored just to eat, why there's got to be strife, and why there's got to be division, why there's got to be disease, why there's got to be death, the struggle that we struggle with now, Romans 8:18 says, for I consider this suffering is not worthy to be compared. It's not even worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed, not just in his second coming. Get it? It's not just, well, one of these days there's going to be glory when he returns. No, in us. The glory which shall be revealed in us. And that, we go through issues in this life and there's struggle that happens, but because he came, now I have glory in me. And I don't even compare one to the other because there ain't even no comparison. And so this passage of Scripture, for I consider that the suffering is not even worthy to be compared to the glory being revealed in us and will be revealed one of these days. Father, I thank you for this, that your glory has been poured out on us. We thank you, God. May every one of us be sensitive to the heavenly realm that is here and now, that we are eagerly expectant. We live in expectancy, looking for your kingdom activity all around us at every moment. Lord, I pray that today you just move amongst your people. I know that you are. I pray that your people will be sensitive to it and respond. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to have our prayer team down at the front. You can come and pray with them. Whatever it is, Lord, might be stirring in you, you come and respond. The altar's open. You move as we sing.
Glory. standing, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day, let incense arise. Day and night, night and day. You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. So worthy, for from you are all things. To you are all things. You deserve the glory. You're worthy of it all.
Prayer teams will remain available on either side of the platform for continued prayer. Or the altar's always open for doing business with the Lord. As we close out, a couple announcements. Love Thy Neighbor tonight at Gates Community Church, 6 p.m. Again, that's Love Thy Neighbor, Gates Community Church, 6 p.m. tonight. Resurrection Weekend is coming up this Friday. We will have at 7 p.m. right here in the sanctuary a encounter night. Praise and worship night. We come together as a faith family, and we lift our voices to our awesome God on Good Friday. Saturday, we'll have one service at 5 o'clock, and then Sunday, our normal services. And then we have this will be posted to the church website and all our social media, but it's Passion Week services. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, at noon every day, there's going to be a community service. The first one tomorrow is going to be held at Athens First Methodist Church. And if you make it there tomorrow and you're interested in that, they will have these there as well for you to pick up. But we will get this on our webpage and our social media pages, so be looking for that. With that, as we close out, our welcome room, if you are a first-time guest or a regular attender and you want to know more about us as a faith family, we'd love to get to know you. Again, those are these two doors off to your right. With that, we'll close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that you sent us. All power, all honor, and all glory are his, Lord. We thank you for the blood, that triumphant entry into Jerusalem, the victory lap before his death, that he comes in, defeats sin for our eternal salvation. And we look to that, Lord. We're going to continue keeping our eyes on you. And we ask through this week, Lord, that our spiritual ears be so sensitive that any vibration amongst each other and in your creation, Lord, that we feel it in our soul, in our spirit, Lord. And we continue to profess and proclaim you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We love you, Lord. And we thank you for everything. I pray blessings over everyone here today. Keep them safe. Watch over and bless them, Lord, as they go out this day and throughout this week. We love you, Father, and we say these things in your name, in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys. Have a great week. I didn't forget anything. No, I didn't. This is a product of rants, people. He just furthered the divide between him and I. I'd like to point out the rants tattoo that he placed on my forearm. If you see that in the picture. Anyways, y'all can thank rants for this. Thank y'all. Thank y'all very much.